welcome to the latest episode of Herman Chien Ho and Sweat and Money. We may or may not have ownership or other positions in the stocks mentioned on the show. Don't buy stocks based solely off what you hear from this podcast, and always do your own homework and research before investing in stocks. This is episode number 35, recorded on April, what is this, the 23rd, 25th?
I have no idea. Worst personal time here.
Oh, geez.
Give me 1 second, let me check.
No, so ill-prepared.
Ill-prepared. 24th.
Ah, the 24th. Ah, see, I was close.
Anyways, close.
So, you know who I am? Kong, along with my co-host, Gibson. So, let's take a look at what's in the news. LA prices are rising, so good news for homeowners. Too bad sales are down, because a lot of those houses are overpriced.
Yeah, dude, you have a very, very expensive house. You're like worth so much. You just can't get money for it.
Yeah, so yeah. Awesome. And even more awesome for those guys who can't afford homes, because, you know, now they can live like nomads.
It might be time to invest in a different city.
Yeah, seriously. All right, so this past Wednesday, April 20th, the EU charged Google with antitrust claims, saying they misused their dominant position by putting Google search into our phones and any device that they could, pretty much, such as Chromebooks and other devices. This after the EU has brought another charge in 2010, saying that deprecating other retailers' results on their search engine was also anti-competitive. We shall see if Google's structure under the Alphabet company system will save them or not. Any thoughts?
I don't know. It's almost shocking. I mean, whenever I pick up an Android phone, I literally do expect a Google search engine there. So if not, I guess whenever you launch a phone, they're going to have to specify which ones you have and how do they list it, you know? Do they go, oh, we sort it by alphabetical order? Because then Bing will come on top. Right. And no one wants to use Bing.
Yeah.
So then there's Google and then Yahoo on the bottom. Or they go, oh, we do it randomly, you know? Never truly random ever. That's going to bring up a lot of questions, really.
Well, I noticed, at least with the Chrome browser, what happens is that, you know, they'll list several other alternatives if you don't want to use Google for the default search engine on their search bar. But then they strategically leave out certain search engines that merely scrape their own results and then take out the ads. So
I think it always brings a question that, you know, let's say you're Microsoft Windows. Well, the default browser is Internet Explorer. So what's it with that? You have the option to switch it out.
It's no longer Internet Explorer. It's Edge.
Is it?
Yeah, with Windows 10.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I'm a slow adopter of the Windows system because, you know, Vista kind of just screwed everything for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Windows 10 is faster, but then, faster than 7, supposedly. But then if you look at the amount of information that it actually sends back to Microsoft, it's kind of scary.
Yeah, that's interesting.
I mean, but then, of course, you know, every modern day operating system is kind of doing the same thing. Apple's Mac OS, so is, you know, Google's Android, obviously. You know, they're sending information back to their company so that they can gain more information on you.
Yeah, hopefully there's a button I could click on to just disable all that sending.
No, there isn't.
Really? Well, good thing I have a firewall.
Yay. All right, now in 2016 Q1, Alphabet, owner of the Google search engine and other former Google ventures, has done a good job making $4.1 billion and is higher than the $3.5 billion made last year. The problem is it's below speculator estimates. So their stocks fell.
That's horrible. I mean, $600 million improvement. And you're like, nah, only $600 million? Why not? Why only 99%? Why not 100%? Why you only have A, not A++? Dad, yes. There is no A++.
Speculators, they're like your Asian parents. All right, well, Mitsubishi Motors now joins Volkswagen in admitting that they cheated on their own emission standards. Keep in mind, however, these are for their cars in Japan. Nothing has been mentioned of their cars made for markets outside of Japan.
Yeah, we only did it for this one tiny, tiny market. All the other cars are free of these emission cheating things. I mean, we wouldn't do it for all our cars.
No, we just don't
like the Japanese, you know.
No, Gibson. See, the Mitsubishi Corporation reserves the right to, also include other nations in this, emission cheating frenzy.
Yeah, I'm just saying, chances are, dude, but all these cars cheating on emission standards, it's kind of... Makes me question how come they got away with it for such a long time.
Yeah, who knows? I mean, well, anyways, yeah. So, Meanwhile, Volkswagen will take their $18.2 billion fine that the U.S. government has slapped on them, according to the Associated Press. Now, the Wall Street Journal, however, says that the fines slapped on Volkswagen are more closer to $18.85 billion. This, however, doesn't mean that the European Union and its member nations won't pursue separate lawsuits.
Damn, that's harsh.
Oh, yeah.
But it does reward all the companies that have been legitimate with their emission practices.
Yeah, because they haven't gotten caught yet. But anyways, consumers are getting...
Hey, good news for Tesla.
Yeah, seriously.
Now, unless Tesla's been cheating on an emission test. Oh, yeah, these electric cars aren't really electric at all.
No, not at all. Now, consumers are getting two choices. One is to get their vehicles repaired by Volkswagen, or two, they can sell back their cars. Which would you choose?
Sell back my car, fuck that.
Haha, are you so sure? Because if you sell back your car, you're capped at receiving $5,000 for your vehicle.
Wow.
Yep.
Wow.
Now, the fine assessed by the U.S. government was enough to bring the entire company into the red for the year, with a loss of $1.77 billion last year in recalling the estimated 11 million cars recalled worldwide.
Is it that easy to fix, you know, like the emission problem? Or did they just, we faked it the first time around and we're just going to put a better faking unit there?
Who knows, man? Who knows? I mean, I'm pretty sure government regulators are going to, like, look after it. You know, kind of like how insurance companies hire agents to look after people who are, you know, make sure that people aren't committing insurance fraud and all that. They actually do hire agents to do that sort of stuff. And, I mean, the government has a lot more resources to hire these people to monitor these companies and their performance. So I'm pretty sure they're going to hire some scientists to look into this.
I hope so, dude. I mean, these emissions are very important for our attempt to stave off global warming or mitigate it somewhat.
Speaking of which, now, in a country where emission standards don't mean anything, Volkswagen is actually seeing record sales in China. And there's a quote here that says, "There is an SUV offensive on the way in the country."
Nice. I mean, I've seen some videos on, I've seen these drivers in China. You need that SUV. But then again, I don't know. I saw a truck get completely derailed by another truck, and an SUV won't save you there. Right. You probably need a tank. That's what you need. Start selling tanks, guys.
Sweet. Yeah, you know what? Yeah, Ford should totally start selling tanks again. Like, yeah. Like they made for the U.S. government in the World War II. They should just start making tanks and sell them to China.
They should. You probably have ownership in Ford. That's why you're recommending that.
Exactly.
Yep. Time to buy some Ford stocks. They start selling tanks to China. I will definitely buy.
All right. So now on to other news. On our last episode, we mentioned some analysts were bearish on the Japanese yen, but we didn't expect it to be this soon that the yen would drop. News that the Bank of Japan would introduce loans with negative interest rates sent a shock to the Japanese yen after having risen due to investors trying to find a safe asset throughout the market turmoil these past couple months.
Well, don't know what to say. I mean, this is pretty straightforward. What?
Well, yeah. I mean, if you can explain to, in layman terms for most of us who aren't economic majors, as to why a raise or why negative interest rates would in turn influence your currency to drop, or is this more of a bursting the bubble of the speculators?
I think it's more so bursting the bubbles of speculators. Okay. Just because they were interested in Japan, so why it went up in value is because they were trying to find a safe asset. So it's like gold, you know. They're like, oh, you know what? Yen is safe. Let's throw money into it. And then there's a limited amount of supply, so there's a lot of demand. Demand kept going up as the turmoil went up, so then that drove the value up. Now, this negative interest rate, though, is, you know, kind of makes it very unappealing. So it counteracts the demand factor. So that's why it's going back down.
Mm. Now, just to clarify, last week they were specifically targeting Abenomics. And saying that was going to fail. But then the thing with Abenomics was that they wanted to have a weaker yen to influence exports. So isn't this actually helping them? So I don't know. I mean, Is this a good thing or a bad thing for Japan?
I think it's a good thing. I mean, they know what they're doing with the negative interest rates. So, yeah, like a lower yen would make their like foreign investors more attractive. And, well, they make foreign investors more interested in investing in Japan. And they probably also want to buy more Japanese goods. So any time where you can reduce the cost to acquire your currency, it will generally increase your sales and exports. It's good for economic reasons, but you know, at the same time, it's your ability to purchase products across the world goes down. So, but I mean, oftentimes when you think about economics, you don't really care about the buying power more so. You care about the activity within your country, like the economic activity within your country, because it's tied to a lot of prosperity and purpose. You know, people having work to do, jobs, you know, things to export, things to sell. Like a constant like mobility and shuffling in your life, you know, like moving up, climbing ladders, so on.
Yeah, well, I mean, despite the fact that Japan doesn't exactly have a robust immigration policy like the U.S. does, and also they're facing a massive crisis with an overaging population and a very, very low birth rate. I mean, their population seems to be declining drastically. So there's not enough young people to support the amount of old people that they're having to support. So that remains to be another issue we'll have to see. So
what you're telling me is that they're overdue for some foreigners like us to help them out with the population problems.
Dude, the political situation in that country is so conservative. I doubt they're going to change. I mean, even if they are going to change, it's not going to be this soon. I mean, they specifically blocked, they created a bill so that if the Japanese prince, that basically killed their monarchy, saying that if the Japanese princess marries a foreign person, then they lose rights to the to succession.
Okay, is that what happened?
Yeah, it was passed like years ago. So, and the fact that the Japanese princess actually has an American boyfriend,
uh-huh.
that doesn't bode well for the monarchy. So, yeah, goodbye, Empress of Japan.
Was he at least Japanese?
Was it?
Was he at least Japanese, the boyfriend?
No, completely like white American.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yeah. Anyways, this coming week, the Federal Reserve will hold another meeting. Investors are wondering whether or not they will raise rates, but unless they see clear evidence of inflation and economic growth, it's highly unlikely they will do so. In other words, the rates will stay the same for now.
Makes perfect sense. Hold your ground until we have more data. Because there's no rush, so...
Yeah. And in other news, one thing that's not going to change is Costco's membership rates. Actually, I'm sorry. One thing that is going to change is Costco's membership rates. Let me rephrase that. Usually every 5 to 6 years, they hike it about $5 for the lower two tiers, and their executive membership, which is the top tier, usually raises about every $10. The last hike was in November 2011. So even if the rate hike doesn't come this November, it's only a matter of time. Full disclosure, I do own stock in Costco.
Yeah, that makes me question this move. I mean, I wonder if that would reduce the amount of membership in Costco. Maybe not. Maybe they're trying to increase the profit margin. It could reduce the number of patrons to Costco. That could have an impact on revenue. At the same time, is that maybe their profit margin is so slim they might want to increase it this way, or they need to increase it this way, or Costco sees this as, you know, the economy picking up and people actually having more money now. You know, the savings that they get from gas prices and so on.
Right.
That, you know what, this fee increase is like minimal compared to everything else and all the savings they get. I think right now this is already $55, so $65 a year.
It's going to be $60 a year because it's $55 right now, right? So it's $5 for the lower two tiers and then $10 for the upper tier.
Oh, yeah, $60. I mean, you know, Costco has really expanded their product line. You know, they sell a lot of fresh groceries.
Right.
They also provide, they sell gas, you know, they have the gas stations, tire swapping services, but that's been pretty standard for a while.
Right.
So I guess, you know, the $5 increase might not have too much of an impact to the patrons. So this, all in all, might be translating to up for Costco.
Yeah, and if anything, I think this might even help their competitors. What is it, BJ's and Walmart-owned Sam's Club. So... Because, I mean, like, if Costco's going to make a move like this, then this also allows Walmart and BJ's to, well, either, like you said, take away some of the customers because it may keep their rates the same, or it may allow them to also increase their membership fees as well, just so that, you know, they can rake in some profits. So,
yeah, we'll see.
So let's take a look at the week in review. Compared to the week prior, the Dow Jones overall jumped 300 points. Or no, I'm sorry, that was from the last week's slide. It jumped. Actually, didn't jump a whole lot compared to last week, because I mean it was around 1,800 points, and I mean Wednesday was at the peak. It was at its peak and jumped up quite a bit. And then Thursday was when it was like, you know, just kept on dropping. Friday wasn't all that great. It seems like investors are actually raking in on some of the profits that they've gained so far. And I think everyone's kind of afraid, like, you know, oh, man, it's going to go down eventually. I'm going to, you know, take what I can so far. So
that's true. I mean, I personally am guilty of taking in. Bank of America actually jumped from 13 to 14. I accept 14. But it actually went from 14 to 15.
Oh, wow.
And I'm like, damn it, I could have gotten an extra dollar out of my stocks. Mm. At the same time, though, it's, you know, Warren Buffett said that you don't have to pick like 100 winning stocks to be rich, you know?
Right.
That you could only pick 10 winning stocks. That's already enough. You know, just you don't have to like select all of them. Just have to be really correct about the handful ones. Now, what was the wisdom behind the statement is that, you know, you have to truly understand what's happening in a company. And if you could truly understand what's going on, then you don't need to have a blanket of a plethora of stocks to make money. You know when it's going to go up. You know what will cause it to go up. You know the driver. Understanding right. In accounting, there's a concept called the driver. Like what makes this company more money? And if they, you know, do things that increase this driver, then the company naturally just makes more money. So if you understand the driver and you understand the forces that cause it to go up, then you're fine. You know, the stock will go up. As the profit goes up, the stock prices will go up. Expectations will continue to go up.
Yeah, no, that's a good explanation. The only thing I have to add to that is the more practical thing with that is the management fees. I mean, the less transactions you're making, the less transaction fees you're going to have to pay. So by keeping it with just a few couple companies rather than buying a plethora of companies and paying all those transaction fees, you're saving yourself quite a bit of money, so then you can plow a lot more of that money into, you know, more stock that you can own. So
yep, that's true.
Now, however, completely contradicts what we were expecting last week, or what I was expecting last week, at least. As we had mentioned, oil was falling because the OPEC nations failed to come to an agreement to cut production, and internationally, the markets fell. I was expecting a similar reaction to the U.S., especially since oil at very low prices means many oil producers would have to shut down, or U.S. oil producers specifically would have to shut down because it would cost more for them to conduct their business. However, the U.S. stock market actually rose on Monday, and it kept rising until, like we said, Thursday, where it fell slightly, possibly due to, like we said, investors raking in. So,
yeah, it's very confusing because then actually a lot of the investors or a lot of commenters on this were actually trying to explain the fact, and they were saying that perhaps the reason why it went up in a way that contradict our understanding of the market was because that the Doha meeting failing was already part of their expectations.
Right,
that was already priced in. So the reason why it went up was that, you know, it wasn't as bad as they thought. They speculated.
So, I mean, is it just a matter? Because, I mean, investors are investors, and there are, I mean, in today's global economy, they're looking at the big picture as a whole. So specifically, why was it that the rest of the world fell, but then the U.S. just went up? Was it because, you know, we had a lead time to look at it and be like, nah, it's nothing big at all? Or I mean, what?
I did predict that at some point one of the forces that can make the United States stocks go up, despite the fact that all the news is extremely bad, is a safe haven effect. If we happen to be the only safe place for all the money to go, then the money would just keep coming at us.
Okay.
Despite the fact that it's unfavorable conditions.
Yeah. All right, so we're not going to look at international markets today because I'm hungry and I want to go get some stuff to eat. Playbook, you know, just a reminder, none of this should be misconstrued as investment advice. I've lost a lot of money, so you definitely shouldn't be listening to me, in short. And plus, there's nothing new. I've still got that one thing. You've already sold your positions on Bank of America.
I'm going to be watching next week to see if Bank of America dips down to 13. I'm probably going to buy again.
Okay.
And I still have the position Caesar, so.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes.
All right, so let's take a look at the week ahead. Monday, you got the Dallas Fed Manufacturing Survey. Tuesday, you got the Federal Reserve meeting, as we mentioned earlier. Thursday is the weekly jobs claims and consumer comfort index, as well as the PMI services flash report. Internationally, you have Wednesday, Bank of Japan is making an announcement. And Saturday, China and Japan's PMI manufacturing index will be released. So, it's funny how it's going to be released on Saturday, though. No?
I think so. You know, this is kind of the reason why I recommend this in highly volatile times, you know, to not hold your stocks over the weekend, mainly because shit like that. You know, like, you have no control over this. And the fastest you can react to that release on Saturday is Monday morning. So unless you're very astute and you're up there at 6 something in the morning, you basically act right there and then you basically get screwed. Like, this can work to your favor and disadvantage. And let's say you're in a long position. If this is bad news, then you're just going to take the hit. You had no control over it. Now, if you were to sell your stocks before Friday, like on Friday, and this news hit and was negative, you wouldn't have to take that hit, whatever it is. And then you could buy it once the hit is over.
All right, recommendations. I got none, again, for this week, so.
Well, I would say watch next week. I think it's a very important time. It could be a bottom. So if the Doha meetings are fail, oil is completely shot, and the stocks continue to rise, then I don't see many forces that can drive the stocks down at this point. You know, like, I was like, okay, oil's going to... See, oil dropping wasn't necessarily a bad thing in the first place.
Right.
You know, oil dropping leads to people having more money in their pockets, more discretionary spending, more disposable income, lower costs for products, you know, lower prices of everything, more could possibly even be more profits, you know. If the cost of transferring all these goods went down, the manufacturing all these goods went down, but the price are exactly the same, and if they go up, that does translate to more profit margins for everyone. I think part of what might be causing the entire stock market to kind of tank a bit is just that they had that extra capital, and oil for them was a safe haven, and they just threw so much at it. At some point, you know, the benefits of oil and its impact on the economy is going to manifest itself. At the same time, is that it's been such a long time for these companies to have that position in oil. Like, since they knew about the problem with oil and the overages and, like, surplus and inventory and so on.
Yeah.
You know, it makes me wonder, like, well, what did they do? Did they just keep holding on to it? Or have they been selling off a lot? And at this point, have they sold off most of the negative positions? And the oil impact might be lower now. But I don't think it's going to be the case. Because, you know, I think a lot of people, with, you know, a few certainties they have is that gas prices will go back up.
Well, that's it for this episode of Home Team Home. The mandatory disclaimer once again. We may have ownership of other positions in the science mentioned in the show, but based on experience, so for the Jeff's podcast, we're going to do any homework and research before we start.